Let's talk about Mexico for the balance of the time we have, a subject that you know extremely well, and it's not unrelated to immigration and some of the other things we've been talking about. Mr. Pena Nieto has been in office now for a little less than a year, is that right?
A little over 100 days, yeah.
So
137.
How's he doing? And what does his time in office say at the moment about relations that we have with our very important neighbor to the south?
Listen, I give him very high marks. And I would take a step back and look at where the country is. Through the year 2000, they'd been essentially a single party country for nearly 70 years or 71 years. And then you had two elections where you elected from what had traditionally been the minority party, the PAN. So you've had 12 years of a little more kind of openness and transparency. When Enrique Pena Nieto was elected, there was a sense, quote, return to the old PRI. Well, I don't think that that was ever possible because you couldn't return to the old Mexico. What you have now is a more open Mexico in terms of the volume of trade that they do with the rest of the world. I mean, I think 60-some-odd% of their GDP is related to trade, which is very significant. That's larger than the U.S. and China. 44 trade agreements. So they have opened themselves up in a way to trade that was going to make being that old kind of PRI, that the old political authoritarianism, was going to make it impossible. Second, that you have a more robust media. There's still areas where competition has to be opened up, but you have a more robust media, so you couldn't return to that. So he actually, and there's a number of factors, but he actually had to run a campaign where he went out and convinced people that he was the person that should be, that deserved their vote. That's a wonderful thing. That forced him to talk about issues like the need for labor reform, fiscal reform, energy reform, in a way that voters had to say, okay, we understand what you're about. And so as he moved, after he won the election, he moved very quickly. And then this is where I think you saw a bit of the OPRI's capacity for governing. And they have a very deep bench and a lot of talent within the PRI. He moved very quickly to get the other parties under the tent, which I think was very smart. Rather than take a PRI victory lap, he moved very quickly to unite the PAN and PRD factions, or parties, around an agenda. It wasn't let's all get under the tent, hold hands, and say we're going to work for the good of Mexico. He says, let's all get in a room several times, sit down, and come up with a whole list of things that we agree we're going to work on. I mean, that is incredibly astute. In the wake of that, through the transition, when you still had the former President Calderon in office, there were a couple of pieces of legislation that had the opportunity, and one of them was the labor reform, and they got that done. So it's as though it was he allowed for, if you will, a gracious exit of his predecessor, a pact amongst the incoming, amongst the parties, an administration full of very effective both operators and technical people, are people that kind of policy people. And so I'd say he's off to a fast start. And the second thing that I'd say is he is the beneficiary of a very sound 17, 18 years worth of macroeconomic policy and stability. You know, it used to be every 6 years you had an election in Mexico and the president got thrown off his horse because there was a devaluation. No, but they've had sound macroeconomic policy, some growth. They're the beneficiaries of a differential with China that is allowing the manufacturing sector in Mexico to grow at a nice pace. If you look at it, whether it's, you know, vis-a-vis China, the wage differential has narrowed, the energy costs, the proximity to our market, so there's growth there. And so he's a beneficiary of sound macroeconomic policy, good political judgment. I think what they have to do is manage expectations, get a couple of more of these of his initiatives on reform done. Certainly energy is a big one. You'll probably want to spend a little time on that. But if they do that, there's no reason in the world why they can't move from about 3.5, 3.7% GDP to 4.5. That's significant.
So you feel good about it, and optimistic about it.
I think really the interesting thing for this administration is going to be managing expectations.
Yeah.
Because if you look at the less than a handful of years ago, the only story coming out of Mexico was security and violence. And that continues to be a challenge, but that was the only story coming out. Now you can't pick up whether it's The Economist and their special report on Mexico. The Financial Times has referred to Mexico as the Aztec Tiger. If you look at these things, you realize in terms of the emerging markets, nobody is better positioned than Mexico.
Yeah.
They are writing now, and I think for the next decade, the same story that you saw written about Brazil for the last decade.
Right.
That's a very good thing for Texas.
But you acknowledge that the security questions continue, even though that's no longer the only story that's being told. There are still people in Texas, we're obviously particularly interested in the fate of Mexico and in the relationship between this country and Mexico, who will say, I've got to go to business on Mexico, I've got to go to Mexico City on business, or I might want to go to Acapulco or Cancun or Puerto Vallarta on vacation. There's still an anxiety here about whether conditions in Mexico are safe. We still hear about reporters and others along the border being kidnapped, threatened, killed. Have conditions in Mexico adequately improved in that respect, or are we simply just hearing about other things, and so the security story is not necessarily better, but it's just in competition with other stories to be told?
I think what you're hearing is a more balanced story. And let me pick on Brazil for a little bit, and not so much pick on Brazil, but just use them as a point of reference. The Brazil story has been very positive for the last 10 years. It's starting to flatten out because of the economics.
Yeah.
But by virtue of the fact that they didn't sit on our border, all we heard were the economic stories. Had Brazil sat on the border, we'd also hear poverty stories and crime stories that would frighten most Texans.
Right.
And so what you're hearing out of Mexico now is more balanced. You're getting the economic news because the press is starting to cover it, I think, and they were kind of picking winners in today's global economy is tough. There's not that many. One of them happens to be Mexico. And the second part of that is, I think, as people go to Mexico, certainly investors can manage around some of the security issues. I mean, whether it's through private contracting and these sorts of things. And then thirdly, I think folks are getting more aware of the need for simple situational awareness. And by that, what was that old country lawyer that used to tell the jury before they went back into the jury room, don't leave your common sense in the courtroom. Take it back there with you when you decide this case. My advice to people is don't leave your common sense at the border when
you
go south.
Be smart.
Be aware of where you are. Listen, there are places in my hometown of Brownsville that if I wander off at the wrong time of day, I'm going to be in trouble. And so, I mean, do not be wandering off. We saw some really dumb things done around spring break. And it seemed like every kid that would do something really crazy had a dad who was this close to the congressman. And I was immediately having to explain, look, I'm not trying to minimize it. I'm saying be smart when you're traveling. Sure, there are places that you can get yourself in trouble the wrong time of day in the wrong part of the city. There are places and you get yourself in a lot of trouble real quick. But just be smart when you're traveling, and I think you'll be fine. And certainly most of the tourist areas, you'll hear some blips. You've probably read a little bit about more activity in Cancun that is troubling, Acapulco that's troubling. You get down along the Mayan Riviera and you're going to be fine. You get to Mexico City, where I spend four and a half days a week, and I got to tell you, it is a beautiful city with a great history.
And you would have no hesitation about recommending somebody to travel there on business.
Well, I know you'll be there in June, and I'm looking forward to seeing you.
Okay.